Probably they will open for the elder children schools, but the younger ones, the kids, for them, I think it will take a while.
Yes, yes, yes.
Time to open. Yeah.
To get the situation totally normal.
Yes.
So, sir has got NASA Technology Brief Award 2007 for the technology entitled Advanced Research Award 2012 from Japanese Society for Powder and Powder Metallurgy. So, sir, by this time, till the attendees join, can you just brief about your institute? I mean, so that our audience, whoever has joined, can get a little idea.
Yeah, I think I have one or two slides initially to just say about our institute and the focus areas. So I think I can cover, but of course those are which are specific to the coating field. But apart from that, our institute, as you know, it is part of a CSR family. Here mostly Odisha is actually blessed with so much of mineral resources. So most of the focus here is to mineral processing, metal extraction, and of course the advanced materials development, technology development. So here basically we have about five R&D departments. Mineral processing technology is one, and hydrometallurgy is another, then advanced materials technology, then these colloids and this materials chemistry department, and of course environment and sustainability department. So like that, we have five, six R&D departments. So most of the coating work actually we are doing in this department, this one and advanced materials technology department. So, but major emphasis of our institute is for mineral processing, metal extraction. Nowadays, you will not find many institutes dealing with extractive metallurgy. So all of them have either converted to materials research institutes or lab. Only very few, our institute and of course ISM Dhanbad, they are doing mineral processing. And I think Bhopal, we have a CSR lab.
So, yeah, Ampri.
Yeah, but they have also, their orientation was very similar to us earlier, but they have actually done away with mineral processing. Now they are mostly materials development and composites and so on. So, yeah.
Okay. प्राची चेतना मैम ने ज्वाइन किया क्या या आई हैव सेंड द लिंक एक्चुअली अनदर साइंटिस्ट फ्रॉम एम्प्री शी इज अबाउट टू ज्वाइन सो आई एम जस्ट टेकिंग डॉक्टर चेतना
यस एम्प्री इज आवर सिस्टर लैबोरेटरी
या So what are the instruments that are available for thin film? I think slip casting, tape casting, these traps
yes.
are available, no, sir?
Yeah. All these things are there, standard.
Okay. Sir, particularly in which city you are resided now?
No, this is in Bhubaneswar. Bhubaneswar. Yeah. So this is about 60 kilometers from the sea. Puri, you must have heard.
Yeah,
Puri is the Jagannath temple. So this is about 60 kilometers west of that. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. But I have been to many other cities. It's not a big city. It's a medium-sized city. Not many industries, so government has a strict policy not to allow any polluting industries here. So that is one of the good thing here, which I like. They don't give permission to set up any kind of polluting industries. So that's why air is a little bit clean compared to That's why when I visit like big cities, we feel like somewhat suffocating. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So, Jyoti ma'am, how many participants?
Ma'am, 22 number is increasing continuously. So, I think we should start now.
Or just, I think Dr. Chetna is about to join. So, just, sir, with your kind permission, we're just waiting for 2 minutes. So, that's
yes, yeah. Sure.
Okay, sir. And later on, sir, we are interested for any kind of online certification course if something is going on in your institute for our students. So,
specifically, there are many different types of certificate course also going on. But again, depends on what kind of courses they will be interested. So
the material characterization related material.
Yeah, those kind of things are being offered. Yeah, we have a central characterization center. They do offer this certification programs where students can have hands-on experience to deal with characterization analysis of the materials.
Okay. Huh. So, okay, fine. I think Chetna ma'am is about to join. I was checking, sir, your recent publications. So, many super hydrophobic coating you have worked on, and graphene coating on copper.
Yes. Mostly our emphasis has been on corrosion resistant coating and this tribological coatings, erosion and wear resistant coatings. So here, this ceramic as well as graphene and also polymer and their composites. So all these kinds of so I'll be just giving an overview of.
Okay, fine.
This year.
Fine.
So it's going to be more of a general overview of our things which you have done or are doing and. Maybe one case study kind of thing.
Okay, sure. So Jyoti ma'am, the number of participants, I think
25, but Chetna ma'am is not seeing the still.
Okay, sir, let me just call her up for a minute. Prachi, please check for this Kapil sir.
Ma'am, I can also take her on panelist list, Chetna ma'am. Otherwise she can't speak.
Okay. So Jyoti ma'am. I think Jyoti ma'am, you need Chetna ma'am's email ID. Do you have her email ID?
I will inform Raman. Okay, ma'am. I will inform Raman, sir. Chetna ma'am.
Yes. Jyoti ma'am, I have sent you, mailed you Chetna ma'am's email ID. हाँ, चेतना मैम को कॉल कर लो एक
यस
Okay, I think Chetna ma'am will join after some time because she had got engaged in the meeting. So I think Jyoti ma'am, we can start. Okay. So, okay. Then Jyoti ma'am, shall I start now?
Yeah, sure.
Kapil sir has already joined. Yeah. So Kapil sir, you can unmute for the time being. so that I can introduce you with Dr. Besra. Kapil sir, are you there?
Yes, madam.
Okay. Okay. Kapil sir, yes. Let me introduce Kapil sir. Kapil sir is the HOD of our civil department. And here is our distinguished speaker, Dr. Besra. He's the chief scientist in CSIR Lab, Institute of Minerals and Materials Technology, Bhubaneswar.
Welcome, sir. Welcome.
Yeah, good afternoon to everyone. It's nice to be here.
Okay, now let me introduce all of our dear students and faculties who have attended, who are attending today's webinar. We are privileged to have Dr. Besra. Dr. Besra is a chief scientist and head materials chemistry department, professor, Academy of Scientific and Innovative Research, CSIR, Institute of Minerals and Materials Technology, Bhubaneswar. Dr. Besra has completed his PhD from IIT Kharagpur in 2003. Okay, I joined at IIT Kharagpur in 2003. That time
yeah,
is that. Chemistry. Okay. And MTech from IIC Bangalore, Metallurgical Engineering, and BTech from NIT Rourkela. So he has a 27 years of R&D experience, joined IIMT Bhubaneswar as scientist B in 93, work in different capacity, like starting from scientist C, senior scientist, principal scientist, senior principal scientist, and now chief scientist. He has completed two postdocs at Georgia Institute of Technology, GATEC, Atlanta, and National Institute of Material Science, NIMS, Tsukuba in Japan. And sir presently is working as chief scientist, as I've already mentioned. He has received a couple of honors and awards in his career. Advanced Research Award 2012, Japan Society for Powder and Powder Metallurgy. He has been awarded by NASA Technology Brief Award in 2007 for the technology title Electrophoretic Deposition on Non-Conducting Substrates. NIMS Postdoctoral Fellowship at National Institute of Material Sciences, NIMS in Tsukuba. IIME Best Paper Published Award on Environment Issues Related to Mineral Processing for the year 2007, instituted by Indian Institute of Mineral Engineers. IIME Best Paper Award on Beneficiation for the year 2004, instituted by Indian Institute of Mineral Engineers. Boys Cast Fellowship from DST in 2003 and 4, German Academic Exchange Service DAT Fellowship Sandwich Model in 1998-99. His research areas of interest are advanced materials processing and coatings by electrophoretic deposition, HVOF, and cold spraying for corrosion prevention, thermal barrier coatings, and tribological applications. Colloidal processing of ceramics, gel casting, slip casting, tape casting, etc. for near net shape fabrication. Solid oxide fuel cell as future clean energy generation system for direct conversion of chemical energy to electrical energy. Interfacial phenomena of particle suspensions, mineral processing, size reduction, flotation, gravity separation, solid liquid separation, including dewatering of industrial sludges. Publication, Dr. Besra has 80 publications which are highly cited in SCI journals, and one review paper on electrophoretic deposition published in Progress in Material Science in 2007, and has got 1810 as citation. He has published two patents, sir is having, and the students guided PhD 4 and MTech 5. So with a vibrant CV, after reading, go through that, I'd like to request Dr. Besra to start your lecture. Sir, please go
thank
ahead.
You. Thank you, Dr. Sudeshna Ray, for a very exhaustive introduction. Welcome to all the participants. As Dr. Ray already mentioned, the focus areas of my research and my institutes So today, actually, I'll be talking about this coating. Let me share my slide. So can you see my slide? Can you see my slide?
Yes, sir. Slides.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Not in the slideshow mode. We can
okay,
see.
Okay. Okay. Just yeah. Now I have made it to the slideshow mode. Okay.
Yeah.
Is it okay now?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thanks again, Dr. Ray, for the introduction. So as I have said, this will be my topic, the protective coatings by electrophoretic deposition and cold spraying for industrial applications. And this is the picture of my institute, which is a CSIR institute. I belong to the materials chemistry department there. And this is a brief about our institute. It is in Odisha, in the city of Bhubaneswar, which is also called the Temple City. And Odisha is blessed with many scenic beauties and natural habitats of this bird sanctuary and so on, in very near to Bhubaneswar. So you can take time off and visit Odisha sometime if you have time. But this is different departments of our institute. We have this mineral processing technology, advanced materials technology, materials chemistry, to which I belong, environment and sustainability, hydro and electrometallurgy, design and project engineering, and process modeling and instrumentation. So in our department, particularly with regard to this surface engineering and coating, we mostly work on coatings for corrosion prevention and tribological applications, with application areas mostly in mining, metallurgical, chemical, oil and gas, aerospace, marine, and other applications which are listed here, mostly for industrial applications, because that is the mandate of our CSIR labs. And here, this will be the outline of my presentation. I will briefly give you an introduction about what is an electrophoretic deposition, and also show you how versatile this technology can be, so that it can be applied to many different applications. And I'll give you a case study, which is for this ceramic coating for corrosion prevention. Particularly this TiO2 coating that we have done. And finally, give you an overview of this cold spray coating, which we are also doing. And finally, summarize my presentations. The motivation is that now corrosion and erosion, or this wear, abrasion, these are major issues in most of the industries, whichever industry, whether which I talked about, mining, metallurgical, chemical, whichever industry you talk of, these are major issues. And actually, because of this corrosion, this problem, India loses a major, about 3 to 4% GDP annually because of the corrosion losses. So you can imagine kind of losses which is happening because of corrosion. And because of this, machines will not, machines will fail to function as per their desired design specification. And also there may be life-threatening accidents resulting in loss of lives and environmental damage and so many things. So in this regard, what we are emphasizing is to ceramic coatings, because they are very promising, not only for mitigating corrosion and erosion, and also for high temperature oxidation resistance. So that's why we are focusing mostly on the ceramic coatings. Of course, we work on other non-ceramic materials like graphene, carbon nanotube, polymer, and their composites also. But today my focus will be mostly on the ceramic coatings. And these are the surface engineering activities at CSIR IMMT. You can see that we apply these coatings for many different applications, corrosion and erosion, which I already said, thermal barrier coating, tribology, functionally graded materials development, biocompatible coating also we do, and also hybrid materials and hydrophobic and super hydrophobic coatings and solid oxide fuel cells. And we have all these state-of-the-art techniques like EPD, electrophoretic deposition, plasma spraying, HBOF, flame spray, cold spray, sol gel, and so on. And also the characterization tools necessary to characterize these, which are listed here. Apart from that, we have a central characterization facility where all the standard tests and characterization can be done in the institute. But today I'll focus mainly on this electrophoretic deposition and cold spray. So to introduce what is an electrophoretic deposition, it is very similar to electroplating where you have two electrodes and you have particles in suspension. The particles which need to be coated on the electrode are in the suspension, and you apply DC electric field, and these particles have an inherent charge when they are suspended in a liquid. And depending on the surface charge, they will move to the oppositely charged electrode and get deposited there. So principle is very simple, but it's not as easy as it looks, because there are a lot of surface chemistry involved in it, so which I'll be covering briefly. But the advantages of this are many advantages, because you can coat on any type of substrate, not only on flat surface, but also on tubular or even complex shapes you can coat, and different type of materials. You can coat metals, ceramics, polymers, carbon nanotube, graphene, and or their composites also. And good thing is that it is very fast. The kinetics is very fast. So anytime within 30 seconds to 3 minutes, your coating is done. And you don't need very fancy apparatus for that. You just need a DC power supply, and that's it. And the process parameters are also easy to control, like applied voltage, time, or electrode distance. So you can control the thickness of the coating or the quality of the coating by simple adjustment of these operating parameters. And you normally don't use much binders here, because we don't prefer to use binders. And so these steps can be eliminated. So, and one important thing is it is easy to scale up. You can customize the electrode design in such a way you can make a smaller component coating as well as a bigger component coating by this EPD. So it is also a low cost process and suitable for mass production. And the most important point here is it's not a line of sight process. Line of sight means the coating in a straight line, because the coating here follows the electric field path. And electric field path is not necessarily straight line. It can be a curved line. So it is not a line of sight process. So that is the biggest advantage of this process. And some key considerations here is that you have to choose a suitable solvent so that the particles are completely dispersed. There should not be any agglomerates, because if you have these agglomerates, they will not give you a good quality of coating. Ideally, you should have a discrete particle suspension there, so that you get a very homogeneous coating. And this solvent should be such that they should be able to impart surface charge, because your driving force here is the surface charge on the particle. It can have a positive surface charge or a negative surface charge. So depending on surface charge, you can either coat on cathode or anode. So it can be cathodic EPD or anodic EPD. So this solvent should be chosen very judiciously so that it imparts sufficient surface charge. And it should also ensure that stable current density. There should not be too much of current fluctuation during the deposition process. Otherwise, your quality of the coating will suffer significantly. And of course, low viscosity, because if there is a very viscous, it will be a lot of drag. So low viscosity is required to minimize the drag, and low surface tension because and low evaporation rate. Otherwise, there will be a lot of cracking during the drying and sintering. So these are the few key considerations which one must keep in mind when designing or deciding about the EPD process for application. This is just an example of few solvents which are commonly used. And here, the most important thing is viscosity, which I have said, and the relative dielectric constant. Dielectric constant is nothing but the dissociative power of the solvent. Okay, so if this this liquid have a low dielectric constant, there will be insufficient dissociative power, and so the particles cannot acquire the necessary surface charge. So there will not be any deposition. But on the other hand, if you have a very high dielectric constant, so there will be excess ions, dissociated ions in the liquid, which will participate in the deposition process. Ideally, in this technique, actually, you want the current should be carried by the particles and not by the ions, okay, not by the free ions. Otherwise, preferentially, these excess ions will participate and your particles will not participate in the deposition process, and so there will not be any deposition. So there is an optimum intermediate range of dielectric constant and low viscosity and stable current density, which are necessary to get the desired properties of the coating. On the right hand side, actually, I just show you how current density fluctuation you can visualize here. For different applied voltage, 50 volt, 100 volt, 150 volt. Just by looking at this, you can see that at 50 volt, the current densities are very stable. There is not much fluctuation. 100 volt, little bit of fluctuation. And more than that, it slowly increases the fluctuation. So roughly, when you are choosing a solvent, you can first just carry out this current density variation as a function of time. And in this case, we can roughly say that 50, you can get a very good coating, and 100, maybe a little bit of fluctuation on the surface morphology you can get. But beyond that, you are expected to get a not so good quality of coating. So this is just a thumbnail and guideline which will help you to decide the kind of solvent for this application. Okay, so these are the factors which I have listed here. It can be categorized mainly the factors which are related to the process and the factors which are related to the suspension itself. So you have seen this equation, which the weight deposited per unit area of electrode is shown by this equation. You can see that there are inherent the properties like permittivity, relative permittivity of solvent, viscosity, etc., which are fixed once you have chosen your solvent and your particle. But the parameters that you can play around is concentration of the particles, applied potential, and the distance between the electrode and the zeta this deposition time. So just by varying these parameters, you can actually affect this coating process. Now coming to the suspension parameters, this particle size, zeta potential, dielectric constant, and viscosity, these are already fixed once you have fixed. But the most important parameter is the pH, because pH, by varying the pH, you can actually control the extent of surface charge on these particles. So you can increase or decrease, and depending on this pH, this surface charge, and so you can affect that can control the quality of the coating that you get. And this slide shows you just how, by controlling the particle size, you can control the quality of the coating. On the left-hand side, you have 3 micron size particles, and on the right-hand side, 0.06 micron. Just by changing the particle size, you see that you are getting so good quality coating on the right-hand side. Okay, so coming to how versatile this EPD is, here I have shown you that you can coat on the flat surface and also on the tubular surface and on the complex shapes like on the right hand side, you can see a car body. It is actually not a big car body, but a toy, just to demonstrate the complex shape coating. Actually, I have shown here that you can employ this technique. In fact, as far as I know, some of the car companies like BMW do apply this electrophoretic coating technique to provide this primer coat on the car bodies. So this is a very effective tool to provide coating on all the kinds of shapes, all types of surfaces, whether it is flat, complex, or tubular surface. Coming to the application of this, you can see from the literature, this I have taken from the literature, you can see a whole lot of applications in many different materials application, starting from dye sensitized solar cell, then super hydrophobic coatings, multi-layer ceramics, freestanding films, solid oxide fuel cell, automobiles, and so on. So it has a very flexible application in many different fields. And this is just to show you, you can make laminates if you want to. This is just a TIC and SIC laminates. You can coat a first layer of TIC and just transfer this solvent or the suspension, replace the suspension of TIC with SIC. And alternately, you can do this to get this kind of alternate layers of TIC and SIC. Similarly, functionally graded materials, you can prepare different constituents with increasing or decreasing concentration of these materials. In this case, I have shown you tungsten carbide and 6 cobalt, 2 tungsten carbide, 25 cobalt. You can vary the concentration of this tungsten carbide and cobalt and get this kind of graded gradient in the microstructure of these coatings. And I talked about bioactive coatings also. These are some of the work which you have done for the implant coating on the biocompatible coating on implants, bio implants. So normally people use this hydroxy apatite, which is a material of choice because it has this similar composition as the bone. But only problem is that there is a lot of thermal expansion coefficient mismatch between this titanium metal implant and this hydroxy apatite. So you get poor adherence. And another important point, which I have not listed here, is the strength. The modulus of rigidity of this hydroxy apatite is very low, so they are fragile. So here what we have done is, but hydroxy apatite is very much compatible with the bone. So here what we have done on the titanium implant, material, titanium substrate, we have first coated titanium oxide. Since there is titanium in both, so it is very compatible to each other. And so we get a first layer of titanium oxide. And on the titanium oxide, we have coated this hydroxy apatite. Titanium oxide itself is also biocompatible. Now hydroxy apatite is also biocompatible. So there will not be any issue with regard to biocompatibility. So you can see on the left-hand side, it is porous hydroxy apatite coating on titanium. And on the right-hand side, this is the TiO2 coated on titanium by this EPD. So this is at 50 volt, only for 5 seconds, you get this kind of TiO2 coating on this titanium. And on this, we have coated the, on this titanium TiO2 surface, we have coated the hydroxy apatite. And we have characterized with regard to different characterization tools, your microstructure by SEM or EDAX, and also Raman spectroscopy to check whether these coatings, the characteristic peaks of this hydroxy apatite and the TiO2 are present or not. So we have verified all those, and these peaks are already also shown in this Raman peak and So we are confirmed that these coatings are indeed there. And this is a corrosion comparison. This 1, 2, 3, 1 is titanium foil, 2 is hydroxyapatite coating, and 3 is the hydroxyapatite and titanium hydroxyapatite bilayer coating. Okay, you can see very clearly the first plot that the open circuit potential at increased significantly in the bilayer coating of titanium and hydroxyapatite. And so in the potential dynamic polarization result also, you can see that compared to the titanium foil, the titanium HAP bilayer coating has a much lower corrosion current, much lower corrosion current, and more positive e-corrosion, because the corrosion potential. So that means it is more resistant to corrosion. So the same thing, the microstructure of these corresponding samples are shown on the right-hand side, this hydroxyapatite on titanium, and on the right-hand side, you can see half hydroxyapatite TiO2 bilayer on this titanium. In this table, you can see the bare titanium, the E-core and I-core values. Compared to that, you can see that much lower I-core values for this half TiO2 bilayer and more positive E-core values for this bilayer coating. And these same samples have also been tested by our collaborator in Central Drug Research Laboratory, Lucknow. And they have tested about the in vitro test, cell viability test, to check the biocompatibility. And compared to the controlled samples, they have a very comparable performance, so which is a good thing for us. And talking of versatility, you can also make what is called textured ceramic. Textured ceramic means the grains or grains in the microstructure can be oriented in a particular direction. So giving you a textured microstructure. So this kind of texture structure can be made for any non-cubic materials with anisotropic magnetic susceptibilities. For example, if they have a difference in the magnetic susceptibility in different direction, parallel or perpendicular direction. So the energy of crystal anisotropy there is related to these differential magnetic susceptibility anisotropy by this expression. Here you can see that it is directly proportional to the applied voltage, and it is square of the magnetic field. So if you can conduct this electrophoretic deposition in a strong magnetic field, you can expect to have a anisotropic this texture ceramic. I have shown here schematically, where we have done this alpha alumina coating in a strong magnetic field, about 12 Tesla. It's very high magnetic field. And this XRD on the right hand side, the first one shows. Yeah, here you can just note the basal plane, that is 006. You can see that when you take the XRD from the top of the sample as well as from the side, so there is no 006 peak. That means the at 0 Tesla, that means at no magnetic field, you have all the grains are randomly aligned, okay, randomly oriented. But when you do the experiment at 10 Tesla or 12 Tesla, you see that when you take the XRD from the top, you see that 006 peak starts appearing. That is because of the alignment of these grains in a particular direction. Okay, so you get alignment, get this information by taking X-ray from the top of the surface. But on the side, you will not get the 006 because it is always oriented in a particular direction. So you can visualize this in a much better, it will give you, you can appreciate this fact much better by looking at these microstructures that have been obtained. Here, you can also change the direction of electric field and magnetic field. The relative angle between electric field and magnetic field to modulate and tune your microstructure as you want. You can see that on the right-hand side microstructure, some of the grains are aligned vertically, some are horizontally. So you can get that kind of beautiful microstructure just by changing the angle between the electric field and the magnetic field. And this can be done very easily in a EPD setup, which is contained within the magnetic, which is placed inside a magnetic, strong magnetic field. You can just rotate these sample holders to get change these angles between B and E, that is electric field and magnetic field, so that you get this kind of oriented microstructures. So the corresponding XRD are shown here. First one is for 0 degree. That means this both electric field and magnetic field are oriented parallel to each other. And the second one is at 45 degree, angle between B and E 45. Third one is 90 degree. So you can see that you can just look at this 006. There is at 0 degree, it is there. Whereas in 45 degree and 90 degree, it disappears. So that signifies that there is a the orientation of the grains have changed by doing this kind of experiment in a strong magnetic field. And you can also create a patterned microstructure. This is just an illustration of creating this kind of ordered microstructures using model PMMA particles. You can see that this kind of microstructure can also be made through this EPD process. So that is all about the versatility of this EPD. Now I will touch a little bit about how you can do EPD on a non-conducting substrate, because normally EPD can be done only on the electrically conductive substrates. But when it comes to non-conducting substrate, you can do some innovative approach. I will cite one or two ways how you can do EPD on non-conducting substrate. The first one is by judiciously choosing the porosity of your substrate. Okay, so this particular thing, example, we had done for application in a solid oxide fuel cells. In solid oxide fuel cells, you actually have nickel oxide and yttrium stabilized zirconia, these composite particles pressed as pellets as the anode. They are called the anode of the solid oxide fuel cells. And on anode, you have a dense layer of yttrium stabilized zirconia. And above yttrium stabilized zirconia, you will have a dense porous layer of cathode. So that is the configuration of solid oxide fuel cell. You have three layers, all ceramic components, the porous anode, that is nickel oxide wire jet, dense electrode, that is yttrium stabilized zirconia, and a porous cathode. That is normally people with lanthanum, strontium, manganite. So this kind of microstructure development, porous, dense, porous is very difficult. But here you can do it easily using electrophoretic deposition. So we have first made nickel oxide YSZ pellets and pre-sintered them at different temperatures from 1100 to 1400 degrees C. And we measured their porosity. So 1100 degree, you can see 52%, 1200, 43%, 1300, 32%. So and 1400 pre-sinter sample is 22%. So you can make different porosity of these samples. So we took these different porosity samples of nickel oxide YSZ composite pellets and tried to do EPD of this SOFC electrolyte material, that is ETS stabilized zirconia, on those pellets. Using this kind of arrangement, which we have done, you see that the green one is that porous pellet. And on the backside, we have put a carbon sheet. And that carbon sheet is connected to a spring contact to our negative terminal of the DC supply. And on the right-hand side electrode holder, the right here you have the counter electrode, say platinum or any other material. And whole thing is now dipped into ETS stabilized zirconia suspension, and then electric field, DC electric field is applied. So these ETS stabilized zirconia particles, which are charged, they are positively charged. So they will move towards this negatively charged thing, electrode, which is a porous substrate. But since the porous substrate is saturated with this liquid, you can visualize that there will be an electric field on the front of this porous substrate. So you can get a coating on the surface of the porous substrate also. That is on nickel oxide YSZ composite substrate, you get a coating of ETS stabilized zirconia. On the right hand side, you can see that as you increase the porosity, so the top one is for 1100 degrees C, which is having a higher porosity. So the samples which had a higher porosity, there you get much higher deposition compared to the samples which had a lower porosity. So this is for both, whether you have a applied voltage of 300 volt or 50 volt, these dashed lines are 50 volt and the solid lines are 300 volt. So for both applied field, you see that for higher porosity samples, you get a much higher deposition. So substrate porosity is very important for deposition by EPD on non-conducting substrates. And the mechanism we have actually explained like this, which I have stated also. By doing two experiments, we chose different porosity samples and done experiments at two different applied voltages. And if you extrapolate and plotted amount deposited as a function of porosity, you can see that there is some threshold porosity of the substrate above which the deposition is possible. If you have porosity less than that threshold porosity, the deposition is zero. So this is applicable for both the applied voltage of 100 volt and 25 volt. So porosity is very important. So the mechanism here is that the porous substrate, once dipped into the solvent, will get saturated with that solvent. So you can, and because you have a conductive surface backup on its backside, so you can expect that there will be existence of this electric field on the front face of this porous substrate. So that is the thing which facilitate or enable coating of the particles on the surface of this porous substrate. So using that approach, we could prepare this solid oxide fuel cell. These are pictures of single solid oxide fuel cells. This is nickel oxide YSZ substrate. On this is a green coating of ETS stabilized zirconia electrolyte. And this is now sintered at 1450 degrees C. You can see that this white color has now looks mostly greenish because the coating is so thin, about 10 micron. So it looks like very transparent. So you can see the underneath anode material, that is nickel oxide ETS stabilized zirconia. And on the top of this, we have printed a layer of lanthanum, strontium, manganite, and ETS stabilized zirconia composite to form one single solid oxide fuel cell. This is a single cell, solid oxide fuel cell, whose microstructures are actually this one. And on the left hand side, this is the top surface of this yttrium stabilized zirconia sinter. You can see beautiful surface microstructure. It is devoid of any pinholes or any defect. So perfect microstructure you get. And on the right hand side microstructure, this is a single cross section of that solid oxide fuel cell, which you can see that the cathode is porous, electrolyte is fully dense, and anode is porous. So this kind of microstructure is very important for solid oxide fuel cells because the electrolyte must be completely dense, because normally the fuel cell operates, cathode side is exposed to air or the oxygen, and the anode side is exposed to hydrogen fuel. So if this is not fully dense, there could be intermixing of these hydrogen and oxygen, so it can create catastrophe. So the electrolyte layer is required to be absolutely dense. So we could produce this kind of unique microstructures by electrophoretic deposition. So, and on the right hand side shows you the performance of these single cell. It shows about peak power density of 624 milliwatt per centimeter square, and open circuit voltage of about 1.03, which is very good. Actually, any power density above 500 milliwatt per centimeter square is very good. So in this case, we have got 624 milliwatt per centimeter square. So the work is still continuing to further improve this performance. Another example of doing EPD on non-conducting surface is by pre-coating your substrate with, you can do with a conducting polymer. Let's say polypyrrole is one conducting polymer, or polyaniline, for example. You can pre-coat your substrate because this polypyrrole has a very high conductivity. It is 10 to the 4 Siemens per meter. So you can see this chart. It is very close to metal. So having that kind of conductivity, if you pre-coat on the non-conducting substrate, they can facilitate the EPD on that substrate. And after the coating is done, you can heat treat or sinter it. And since these conducting polymers are organics, so these organics will burn off and you will be left with the coating of your desired material on the non-conducting substrate. So this is the approach. And this polypyrrole coating on the non-conducting substrate, very easily you can do by using this oxidant and dopants. You can start with pyrrole monomer, and you just add the oxidant. In this case, we have done ammonium persulfate, APS, and a dopant, NDA, the naphthalene disulfonic acid disodium salt, NDA, and just mix it well and in an ice bath, and just hang your non-conducting substrate there and leave it overnight, 15 to 18 hours. And on the next day when you go, you see that the surface is coated with a very thin layer of this conducting polymer, that is polypyrrole. The pyrrole has, in presence of oxidant and dopant, has been polymerized now, and they are coated on the non-conducting substrate. In this case, just to demonstrate, here we have used a glass substrate, okay? And next day you see this kind of black color coating on this. It is very thin, actually, about 4 to 5 angstrom thin. So it is very thin coating on this glass substrate. And on this, then you can coat any functional materials on this, the conducting. This is a conducting substrate now when it is pre-coated with polypyrrole. So now you can coat and you get a desired coating of this functional material. Using the same approach, actually we employed to make ceramic filters, graded porosity, ceramic filters with graded porosity. Here we started with a alumina tube, which has a much bigger pores. So on the inside surface of that, we wanted to coat nano-sized alumina so that we get a grading of the microstructure. Porosity should be less inside and it will be more outside. So to make that, we use the similar approach to polymerize pyrrol to polypyrrol inside this tube, okay, and to using this EPD, using this EPD, then we coated the inside inside this pre-coated tube. We coated the nano-sized alumina on this porous tube. So we get this kind of coating. You can see on the lower right-hand side, A, B, C. You can increase the thickness of this coating by controlling the parameters like voltage, time, and concentration. So this is the optical microscope of that coating. So those were how EPD can be used for different applications. Now I'll just give you one case study how we have applied that for ceramic coating, that is TiO2 for corrosion prevention. Yeah, so of corrosion prevention of mild steel. So here what we have done is we clean the substrate by conventional cleaning methods in acid and phosphating. Phosphating is one very important method because even if you have cleaned your mild steel substrate, the moment you expose to air, instantaneously there will be some oxidation, and you'll see that the color of your mild steel becomes slightly reddish. So you know that instantaneous oxidation happens. So just to prevent that, one needs to adopt what is called phosphating. Phosphating is a very commonly used industrial application where you can either dip your steel sample into a phosphoric acid or phenyl phosphonic acid, and that's it. So this surface will be protected from instantaneous oxidation. So first we subjected our samples to cleaning and then phosphating, and preparing the TiO2 suspension and doing the EPD experiment. And after the EPD, we used a binder, which is polymethyl hydrosiloxane, trade name is KF99. And then we sintered the samples. Actually this KF99 or the polymethyl hydrosiloxane is very useful binder because it has this silanol groups there, which help in chemical bonding with the substrate, which is schematically shown in this picture. It forms a MOSI kind of bonding. So you will have a very strong binding when you use this kind of the binding agent like KF99. And then we characterize our samples with all kinds of characterization like your morphology by SEM and then corrosion evaluation, mechanical properties and wetting properties. So I'll show some of them. And this is what happens when you do phosphating of your bare steel. On the left hand side, you see the bare steel microstructure, and on the right hand side, a phosphated steel. The moment you dip it in the phenyl phosphonic acid or phosphoric acid, so you see that the surface of these steel become very corrugated in nature, which is in fact actually good for us because this kind of corrugated surface will help us in improving the binding or adhesion of the coating that we'll be applying on it. So this is a good thing to apply, do this phosphating before doing this coating of these ceramics. And now I'll talk about how to tune and make a stable suspension so that you get a discrete particle suspension so that the quality of coating will be good. So you can do a few measurements like steaming potential or zeta potential and viscosity to tune your suspension. On the left hand side, what you see is the steaming potential of TiO2, which is a steaming potential as a function of pH. So you see that at pH 6.4 is the isoelectric point. That means the particles are neutral. It is not charged at that pH. To the left of that, to the acidic side of 6.4, the particle is positively charged. And to the right of that, it is negatively charged. So theoretically speaking, you can do either cathodic EPD or anodic EPD by choosing your pH. So if you choose a pH to the left of 6.4, the particles are positively charged, so you can deposit the particle on a cathode. But if you choose a suspension pH above 6.4, the surface is negatively charged, so you can have an anodic EPD. So it is very flexible. You can choose your method accordingly. And so in this case, we have actually chosen this on the cathodic EPD, which is about 2 to 3 pH, where we have the maximum surface charge or the streaming potential, so that we have the driving force, we have a higher driving force by choosing the maximum surface charge. This is number one. Number two, viscosity is, as I have told in the beginning, very important. So the right-hand thing shows the viscosity of the suspension as a function of pH. So you see that at pH 2, which is at the bottom, it shows the lowest viscosity. And as you go on increasing the pH, the viscosity increases. The low viscosity is good for us because there will be a decrease in the drag. And we are fortunate that the natural pH of TiO2, when you disperse in that liquid, here we have chosen ethanol, is about 2.3. So it is good for us. We don't have to change the pH by adding any base or acid. Just by putting it the natural pH at 2.3, we can have a highest surface charge and also lowest viscosity. So using that combination of parameters and suspension parameters, these are the microstructures, these are the photographs of the samples, which we could get by electrophoretic deposition at 100 volt applied DC and only 30 seconds to 1 minute, in fact, on different size of the samples. So you can see that you can make a very uniform and smooth coating on smaller samples and as well as very big samples also. So I had told you in the beginning that it is easy to scale up. So this is one illustration how you can coat on smaller sample as well as bigger sample. And just to illustrate how the binder will be useful, this is just to demonstrate on the left-hand side, absence of binder, there are a lot of cracks on the sample. And just by presence of this 0.5 weight percent of this KF99 binder, you can see that there is crack-free coating. And those are the samples at room temperature, but when you heat treat, invariably there happens some kinds of micro cracks on the sample. But if you then treat it using these binders, binders can fill up these micro cracks and bridge those the defects, and you will still retain the corrosion resistance of these samples. So binding agent like KF99 work twofold. One is they enhance the binding with the substrate. On the other hand, they also bridge any micro cracks which are present on the surface due to heat treatment. So it serves to benefit by using this kind of binders. And the mechanism by which these type of binders work, I have illustrated here. It follows two reactions, hydrolysis and condensation. So these siloxan binders undergoes hydrolysis in presence of ethanol solvent, which we have used to produce silanol moieties like this. And this silanol can recombine condensation, and they can make again this thing, the siloxan, and it can again undergo hydrolysis. So there is a continuous hydrolysis and condensation process going on. And these silanol moieties, apart from this hydrolysis and condensation, can also form a bonding with the titanium TiO2 particle like this to form the coating on one hand. And on the other hand, they can also form a binding with the iron particles like this, which is shown on the bottom, to anchor to the substrate. So you see that there are two kinds of bonding happening here because of the presence of this binder KF99. One is anchoring with the substrate, and the other is the anchoring with the coating material. So we could characterize these and confirm by this FTIR spectroscopy. You can see all these characterization peaks, let's say 867, 930, 1030, 1160. 867 is for SiO Fe bond, 930 is for SiO Ti bond, 1030 is for this SiO Si, that is linear linked, and 1160 cross linked SiO Si. So we have confirmed using these FTIR tools. And this is about the mechanical properties of these coatings, which is done by scratch test. Here, what happens, we do this test by applying a progressive load using a diamond indenter, and it moves on the coated surface, and the load progressively is increased. So there are two critical loads. One, first critical load, LC1, is the one where the coating starts to fail. Okay, LC1 is the point where coating failure starts. And there is another critical load, that is LC2, where the coating completely comes off. So just by determining these two critical loads, LC1 and LC2, from these scratch test results, you can determine two very important parameters. One is cohesive strength, the coefficient of friction, which is adhesive strength, by this simple equation. And you can determine which conditions, the samples at which conditions will give you a high cohesive strength, that is CPR, or high coefficient of friction or adhesive strength. So this table actually shows you that for TiO2 coated this phosphated steel with 28% treated KF99 binder actually gives you about 83.3% CPR cohesive strength, although the maximum CPR is obtained at this 100% KF99. But I'll show you later why I have highlighted this is because at 28% you get maximum corrosion resistance. But this value of CPR is also compared to the TiO2 coated PSS, which is not treated with this KF99, still significantly higher compared to this, significantly higher. So it is good for us. And but this one, the last one, the mechanical properties are much better in the 108% KF99 properties, KF99 treated sample. The COF, coefficient of friction, are comparable. It varies between 0.25 to 0.4. So all of these samples are comparable. Here you can do the comparison by looking at the CPR changes. So which one? In this case, the 108% treated KF99 gives maximum CPR value. You can say that the mechanical properties is much better in that sample. And now coming to the corrosion property evaluation, we have done by electrochemical measurements with a area exposure of 1 centimeter square. First, we have done this open circuit potential measurement, and also by impedance measurement in the frequency range of 10 to the power 3 to 10 to the power minus 2 hertz. So this is the schematic of our arrangement of to measure the corrosion property. We have used this silver chloride reference electrode, and you have this working electrode here and platinum as a counter electrode. And these are the typical results of these corrosion evaluation. You can see from the left hand side Tafel plot, this polarization plot, that the black one is for the bare steel, and the pink one, which is 28% KF99 treated sample, gives you the best corrosion resistance. That is the most positive E core values and least current density values, the smallest current density values. So 28% KF99 treated sample is the best in this case to give you the highest corrosion resistance. The same result can be inferred from this Nyquist plot that is obtained by this impedance measurement. You see that the resistance, the resistance is highest for this 28% compared to all other samples. So we can inform the same conclusion that 28% treated KF99 gives the best corrosion resistance. And you can actually model these corrosion resistance parameter by fitting those measured values using this equivalent circuits. Here we have chosen these two circuits, circuit one and circuit two, to know whether how this charge transfer resistance or this polarization resistance is happening, or what is the mechanism of this the corrosion happening in absence of coating and in presence of coating. So we have tried to determine all these parameters by fitting them into this equivalent circuit. And this is a physical significance of how you can visualize. On the left-hand side, you see the charge transfer process during corrosion of steel in absence of any coating. Okay, the RCT is the charge transfer resistance. And on the right-hand side, you have, when you have phosphated the steel, you have a FePO4 layer, then you have a TiO2 coating, and on top of that, you have a KF99 layer. This is just for illustration, but in reality, it is not so clear cut. There is always interdiffusion of this TiO2 coating and this KF99 coating. And compared to the left-hand side, when you have these, when you see the right-hand side image, you see that these ions, corroding ions of this corroding medium, find it more difficult to travel through all these layers for this charge transfer process. So that is how the corrosion can be minimized in presence of all these layers of these coatings. And I was telling that about the interdiffusion, this is just an illustration of how this KF99 and this TiO2 coated coating, there is an interdiffusion between this, which we have confirmed by this EPMA analysis of this interface, where you can see the silicon, titanium, and iron. So there is a lot of interdiffusion of this, this silicon and titanium. So that confirms that it is not a clear boundary, absolute boundary, but there is an interdiffusion of these elements in the coating and the in the coating. And this is a summary of the same thing. The best corrosion resistance is obtained at 28% treated sample. And another important thing is the wetting property. This is another very important property. When we observe that for this 20% wet sample, we have a very high contact angle, about 150 to 160, 150, 151 for 10 weight person and 160 for 20 weight person treated samples. So this kind of, this is a very super hydrophobic, anything above 150 is called super hydrophobic surface. So when you have this kind of super hydrophobic surface, that is very good for us because this corroding solution cannot approach, cannot reach the surface of the metal surface. So it cannot create, cannot cause any corrosion. So if you can impart this kind of surface, super hydrophobic or hydrophobic surface, it is very much beneficial because it will prevent the corroding liquid from reaching the surface. And these are some microstructures from surface topology measured by profilometry. This is just to show even the roughness of these 10 weight percent and 20 weight percent treated samples are higher compared to other, which is again good for us. Okay, now coming to EPD coating on tubular surface. In our lab, we have actually custom designed this kind of setup. Let's say this central tube is the one where we want to coat on the surface, on the outer surface of which we want to coat this ceramic. And so we have a sample, we have a graphite cylinder as the suspension holder. And that graphite also, it is electrically conducting. So that also functions as a counter electrode, whereas our deposition electrode is this center tube, center metallic tube on which we want to coat. So this is our cathode and this graphite is our anode. We have the suspension in between and then we apply the electric field. So since the particles are positively charged, so they will try to move towards the center, the metallic tube, which is at center, which is negatively charged, the cathode. So at the end of the coating time, you will get a coating, a very uniform coating as shown on the right hand side, the picture. The white part is the coating which you have obtained on the surface of the tube. So these tubes actually are, we are doing for a boiler and heat exchanger, in particular the cell tube type of arrangement, the heat exchangers. So these tubes, they are aligned in many numbers inside a cell. And they are actually prone to corrosion. So we were trying to provide this corrosion resistant as well as erosion resistant coating on the surface of these heat exchanger tubes. So both steel tubes as well as brass tubes were there. And we have also done this same, applied for coker tube furnace. This is basically in an oil refinery where actually inside these are long tubes about 600 to 800 meters. They are placed inside a delayed coker furnace tube in refinery. So inside these tubes, your hydrocarbons or the crude oils flow. But since these furnaces are about heated to about 500 degree centigrade. The purpose of this coker furnace is just to heat the hydrocarbons. And there should not be any coking inside these tubes. Coking means coke formation or the carbon deposition. Coke should form after they come out of this furnace, and there is another arrangement called coke drum. So ideally they should be forming in that coke drum. But inherently, it happens, so happens that in an oil refinery, these inside this coker tube furnace, there is a coking happens. Their coking happens inside the tubes, and when they react, these cokes or the carbon which are deposited on the inside surface react with iron. They form very hard clinkers. For example, FeS kind of along with FeS. So they are very difficult, and they choke the, after some time they choke the inside tube, because the diameter of the tube slowly gets reduced. So the productivity of this refinery decreases. So ideally, it is required to provide a coating which will prevent that kind of coking. So we undertook that, and we have provided both alumina and zirconia coating on that. And we have demonstrated by this cartridge heater. Cartridge heater is something which is used to quickly test whether coking is happening or not. It is nothing but a simple rod where after coating, this is exposed to similar environment as these tubes are there in the delayed coker furnace, about 500 degrees centigrade, and in presence of hydrocarbon, which is flowing inside this tube. So, and after exposing these cartridge heaters, they are taken out and see whether any coke has deposited on the surface or not. So on the left-hand side, you can see this is the uncoated tube. On the right-hand side, this is a coated tube, cartridge heater. And after exposing to the hydrocarbon at that temperature, 500 degrees C, this uncoated tube, very strongly adhered coke were formed. Even by hammering, they could not be removed. But on these coated, which we have coated using alumina and zirconia, and super hydrophobic surface. So these, they are very loosely bound carbon deposition. Actually, there are not much deposition, but whatever deposition of carbon or the coke happened, they are very loosely bound. Just by simple tapping by finger, all of these cokes will fall off. So that is very good for application of this kind of coating. Okay, this is just a demonstration of how APD is done in our lab. I think I can fast forward. So first the suspension is being formed. It's ultrasonicating to break the agglomerates to make discrete particles. I can just fast forward it. Now he is pouring into that setup. And then he applies the desired voltage through this DC power source. And after a certain time of coating, the DC is switched off, and now he is taking out the sample. You can see that very uniform coating of this ceramic has happened on the surface in a single go. This is the final coating that I had shown you earlier also. Okay. And this is show you the hydrophobic surfaces which have been formed on this mild steel. You can see the lotus leaf like effect. The water just rolls off the surface. Okay, so that was all about the electrophoretic coating. I'll very quickly skip through this cold spray coating. These cold spray coating are actually relatively newer approaches which we are doing in our lab. So unlike thermal spraying, where you have this powder or wire or rod, which are fast, actually they are melted, and these molten particles are forced at high velocity and they form splats on the surface to this kind of coating. As you can see, here you have a high velocity and also molten particles. But unlike that, in the cold spray, you have only kinetic energy. No, there is no thermal energy involved in that process. So this is, you can coat mostly the ductile materials, but there is a critical velocity above which this cold spray coating is possible. You can see this window, this yellow zone where your cold spray coating of this ductile materials is possible. But if the velocity is very high, then again erosion problem also comes in. So one must balance the velocity in such a way that you get a good coating by this cold spray coating. So this is now very attractive for manufacturing as well as coating, and for repair and modification. And mostly they are now being used in some advanced countries, like for military use and for ship hull, naval hull repairing purposes. And this was actually invented by Professor Perrine when they were studying the two-phase flow of aluminium and copper. And when they impinge on the surface, they form a splat and they formed a coating. So that was the beginning of this cold spray coating process. So here what happens, here you have a compressed carrier gas. Here particle is not heated, only the gas is heated, and the particle are fed heated gas particles are fed into this D-level nozzle. And here now it moves with a very high velocity, about 3 Mach number, and they form a splat on the surface and form the coating. Here, because of the very high velocity, when they reach the surface, the temperature increases, and locally for a very instantaneous moment, the temperature increases, and that is how the coating becomes adhesive, because of the localized temperature rise. This is called adiabatic shear thinning, adiabatic shear instability. Because of that, the coating happens. And as I have said, this is a very good method to coat metallic or the ductile materials, metallic and some composite materials. As long as you maintain some ductility, this process is possible to coat on the surface. And because of the high velocity, actually leads to plastic deformation and localized heat to lead to a transient temperature increase in the particles. And that is how the particles get attached to the surface. So here you can see the for temperature is maximum for the maximum velocity. Similarly, these are high strain rate processes. Deformation of the particles also happens at the highest velocity. So velocity is a very important component of this coating process. And you can have both the high pressure cold spray or low pressure cold spray. Only difference is, the major difference is the pressure. In high pressure, you have 7 to 40 bar. In the low pressure, 6 to 10 bar. So depending on application, both the process finds various kinds of application in industry. And because of the high deposition efficiency of this cold spray, this here it allows for dimensional restoration and manufacture of near net shape products. So cold spray is not just a coating process, but it is also a dimensional restoration and for manufacturing 3D products. And it being a low temperature and high velocity process, there are several advantages. Because of the low temperature, there will be no oxidation of these materials. So you will not have any oxide inclusions in the coating or deposited material, and no porosity, because normally porosity develops during the solidification shrinkage. So here there is no molten particles, only the adiabatic shear instability. So you will have very little porosity. So no porosity in this case. And this is ideally suited for metallic materials. So the same thing what I have said, I have summarized here. These are the merits and these are the limitations. I think I need not repeat this point again. And you have many applications of this cold spray, mostly for corrosion resistance application and wear resistance and tribological applications. Here I have listed all these literatures where this has been applied. And this is a summary of different combination of substrates and coatings which have been explored. You can find all these things in the literature. So it's a wide range of substrates and coating materials have been explored. And this is a typical example of this cold spray application of this aluminium, the nickel coating on this aluminium, aluminium coating on this magnesium alloys. So on the left-hand side, you have this bulk aluminium, and on the right-hand side, you have the cold spray aluminium coating on magnesium alloy. You can see that on the left-hand side, the first one is before immersion in the sodium chloride corrosive medium, and the second one is after one day. It shows severely corroded regions, and within 10 days, you get very deep corrosion pits. But when you have cold spray coated sample, there are fish scale like surfaces. After one day, there is not much change in the surface morphology. And even after 10 days, you can see that these fish scales have been corroded away, and there are signs of some local corrosion, but the no magnesium was found as the main constituent of corrosion product, which indicates that sufficient corrosion protection of aluminium coating. And similarly, there are many examples. Actually, this is to illustrate that the cold spray coating of both T22 steel and SF516. So you see that in both the cases, the coated samples have shown less wet change in this corrosive medium. So that means they are more corrosion resistant compared to the uncoated ones. And this is another illustration of how cold spray can be used. This is a report from the US Army Research Laboratory. So these magnesium components are very extensively used in this aircraft components. And these components are susceptible to erosion and corrosion. And here they have used this cold spray to repair these corroded pits of this magnesium flange. You can very clearly see that they have repaired it very nicely using this cold spray coating. And another beautiful example is that the nuclear fuel, spent fuels, they are actually usually put in a canister and are buried underground for the radioactive decay. Normally, they use about 50 mm thick copper cladded on the steel canister. But when this steel canister were cold sprayed with copper, about 10 mm thick encasement was good enough to provide that kind of service compared to 50 mm. So there are a lot of savings can be done of this copper for this kind of application. And finally, this nickel, this is an example of nickel cold spray coating on this to prevent high temperature fretting wear. You can see that the coefficient of friction of this nickel cold spray coating on aluminium actually decreases significantly when you have coated with this cold spray. And one of the problem is that the ceramic steel that were not possible to coat because they are brittle material, they are not ductile. But recently there have been reports from Japan that by manipulating or tuning the particle sizes, you can affect this cold spray coating of even ceramics. This is an illustration of how they've used nano-sized TiO2 particles. They agglomerate to about 10 to 20 micron and then did the cold spray. And they could enable cold spray coating of the ceramic. So now, people can explore. This is an open field. Even ceramic coating by cold spray coating A lot of work has now been initiated after this report, and a lot of possibilities and opportunities exist in this field. So to summarize, there is a great opportunity on the applicability of EPD and cold spray for the surface protective coating. And I have shown you how TiO2 can be coated by EPD for this corrosion prevention. And there is a huge potential of these cold spray for corrosion protection, dimensional restoration, and also for manufacturing 3D products. And originally cold spray was developed for soft materials, but there is a lot of opportunity now to explore the use of ceramics and ceramics for cold spray. So once again, this is the end of my lecture. And once again, I thank the organizers of Rabindranath Tagore University, and specifically to Dr. Sudeshna Ray, the convener of this webinar, and Dr. Jati Rawat and Dr. Prachi Tagde for having me for this webinar. It was a pleasure delivering this lecture to all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your informative and very insightful lecture. Just a few questions, sir. Very interesting work. By the way, my question is that if suppose we are talking about graphene coating, then on some oxide material, for example, so how we can ensure the bonding between the coating and the oxide? Some XPS tell about the composition. Will the XPS tell about the bonding also? Because you have published paper on the graphene coating. So, I mean, I thought that.
So, we have done the graphene coating for corrosion prevention. So, graphene is inherently negatively charged. So, in that case, that was an anodic EPD process. So, what you said, the adhesion is one of the major issues, not only adhesion, but the stability of the graphene, long-term stability of graphene when it is exposed to a corrosive environment like chlorine, for example. Okay. So nowadays people are actually trying to intercalate some metal ions along with the graphene to increase the stability of these graphene coating in even for prolonged exposure to chlorine like environment. Okay, but you are right that the stability is one of the major issues in case of graphene, and there also we used some binding agents to enhance the adhesion of the graphene to the substrate. KF99 is one. But there are many other organic binders available which you can use along with the graphene to increase the adhesion.
So, sir, this solvent testing or solvent suspension with these process also. Sir, am I audible?
Yes.
With the solvent casting or solvent suspension process, also coating can be made, right? Like thin film coating can be made. So I want to know how we can, and I'm not talking about the stability or durability. I'm talking that if we want to understand the bonding between the coating agent and the substrate, is not metal ion, rather oxide, this sort of material. So how we can understand the bonding, the interface, XPS, or if we know the insight about the bonding between coating agent and the oxide core.
One of the measurement tool that I showed was FTIR, but FTIR will not give you a complete picture. If you want to really explore the exact the species which are actually responsible for these bonding and other things, Probably.
No, sir. I'm asking whether graphene can make a covalent bond or what kind of bond as a coating agent with the oxide.
Yeah, I think those things need to be explored in detail. We have not done the detailed exploration of the exact species which contribute to the adhesion. These are some of the work which one of my PhD student is now doing. So all these characterizations are being planned, and I think maybe in another 1 year time we'll be in a position to tell exactly how these species, how the bonding and all these things are working. So
okay. And sir, another thing, some threshold porosity you are telling, right? So for the porous material, when it is like coating is so it is absorption. So the coat.
No. The porosity that I talked is actually only to ensure the presence of an electric field on the front face of it. Field is a necessity criteria for the particle to come and sit on the surface. So by having a porous substrate, what we are ensuring is the pores get filled with the liquid. Okay. So and these saturated pores work as a conductive path between the conductive surface, which is at the backside of it, and the oppositely charged electrode. So in that situation, you are ensuring the existence of electric field on the face of the non-conducting substrate. So that is the whole idea why you must modulate the porosity of the substrate above the threshold value.
Okay. And you are talking about the binder also. So SiO, this kind of bond also you have seen. So normally for super hydrophobic coating, we see that this kind of silane is normally used to make the surface of low energy. So yes. Sir, the mechanism of, suppose for the making
super hydrophobic. See, the hydrophobicity can be imparted by two approaches. One is by the inherent nature of the binders, that is number one, and number two by tuning your surface properties or the roughness. Okay, so by tailoring your surface roughness or by using a binder which has an inherent property of hydrophobic property like silane, which are very commonly used. So you can tune your hydrophobic. Yes.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Any more questions, Jyoti ma'am, is there? Or
only one question is there. Can this coating be applied on non-metal also, sir?
Can this coating be applied on?
Non-metals also?
Yes. If you can, I told you, if you can make a porous substrate or pre-coat your non-metal with a conducting polymer or something like that,
okay,
it is again possible.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Okay.
Yes.
Subeshana.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir, for this wonderful talk. Now, I'd like to request Dr. Prachi to please provide both of them.
Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon to today's respected speaker, Dr. Besra, Chief Scientist, Material Chemistry Department, and Professor, Academy of Scientific and Innovative Research, CSIR, Institute of Minerals and Materials Technology, our respected convener, Dr. Sudeshna, Dean, Dr. Neetu, Dr. Sangeeta, Dr. Pragya, Jyoti ma'am, and all the faculties and my dear student. I, Dr. Prachi Targe, Faculty, Department of Science, I feel deeply honored as I get the opportunity to propose the vote of thanks to all who have helped us in making this webinar a grand success. First of all, I would like to convey my thanks to our respected speaker, for his thought-provoking lecture on protective coating by electrophoretic deposition and cold spraying for industrial applications. The interesting and informative talk of Dr. Besra has enriched our student as well as our faculties with deep knowledge, with clarities. With this word, I would like to conclude. And again, I am expressing a big thank to all of you. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Pachi.
Thank you
for providing the vote of thanks. And once again, I'd like to thank Dr. Besra. The work is pretty interesting, sir, especially when you're talking about U.S. Army laboratory regarding that coating that for aircraft. So this is cold spraying method is a new one where this kind of aircraft or naval staffs are being coated with.
Not exactly new, but it has been, particularly in U.S. and Japan, it has been employed for this U.S. Army and U.S. Navy kind of application. But in India, I have not seen much. Only, I think, in IIT Roorkee and IIT Chennai, I think, yes. They have started only last year. So we have also started this last year only.
Okay.
So the these kind of activities is relatively new in Indian context.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. We wish to have a long journey with you and your institute with the help of you, so thank that you. Our faculties as well as our students can. Enhance their knowledge so that your in-depth knowledge and very, very insightful lecture can enrich. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.